The Mary of Romanism. I am continuing our study of the Virgin Mary. In the last video, some time ago, we went right through all the New Testament references involving the Virgin Mary, and we presented a scriptural picture portrayal, and a balanced presentation of the Mother of our Lord Jesus. Now having looked at the Mary of Scriptures, in this video, we are going to contrast the way the Mary of Romanism is portrayed, Babylon's Mary. As you will soon see, there is quite a difference. I would like to start this video with a couple of readings from Scriptures. We looked at this verse before, but let's look at it again. Please turn to Exodus chapter 20. And God spake all these words, saying, I am the Lord thy God, which have brought thee out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage. Thou shalt have no other gods before me. Thou shalt not make unto thee any graven image, or any likeness of anything that is in heaven above, or that is in the earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth. Thou shalt not bow down thyself to them, nor serve them, for I the Lord thy God am a jealous God, visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children unto the third and fourth generation of them that hate me, and showing mercy unto thousands of them that love me, and keep my commandments. God warned Israel that one sin he abhorred upon all others, was the sin of idolatry, the putting anyone else in his place, or before him. Now go to the New Testament 1 Timothy chapter 2 and verses 3 through 6. For this is good and acceptable in the sight of God our Savior, who will have all men to be saved, and to come unto the knowledge of the truth. For there is one God, and one mediator between God and men, the man Christ Jesus, who gave himself a ransom for all, to be testified in due time. In the previous video, we see how Mary was a humble Hebrew maiden, and that she was a descendant of King David, and of the royal house of Judah. We also read in Scriptures that in no way did she ever allocate to herself the position of Mother of God or Queen of Heaven. In no way was she able to answer prayer, or intercede. In no way would she have glorified herself, or lifted herself up. All of this was studied from the Gospels of Matthew and Luke, in addition to other passages within the New Testament. We need to ask ourselves a question: how from such a basic biblical beginning did Rome ever take, twist, distort, and to turn the Mary of the Bible, into the Mary that is worshipped in Romanism today? Of course, at the outset, Rome was very subtle, and all these false teachings were brought in slowly. Rome will tell you that they do not worship Mary, and that they only venerate her. Well, we know that is not true. We have all seen the worship and adoration given to Mary by the Church of Rome. We have all seen the pictures of Pope John Paul II bowing in adoration to her statues. To say that they only venerate Mary, waters down or dilutes the perception of their idolatry. Most Protestants don't know that Rome divides worship into three categories. The Romanist who knows his doctrine, and knows his theology, recognizes there are three types of worship. In Latin, the first type of worship is latria, that is the worship that is given to God, or the consecrated host wafer. They have the lowest type of worship called dulia, that is the worship and veneration that they give to the saints. Saint Patrick, Saint Anthony, Saint Christopher. You can take your pick out of hundreds of them. And then in between, they have what is called hyperdulia, a special category of worship that they give to the Mother of our Lord, the Virgin Mary. In addition to this, Rome teaches, and you will see it before I am through with this video, three more doctrines regarding Mary emerged. They teach of her Immaculate Conception. Now many think this refers to the virgin birth, not so. Every form of Christianity believes in the virgin birth of Jesus Christ. The teaching of the Immaculate Conception is that Mary herself was born without the taint of original sin. They also teach her perpetual virginity, and that she did not go on to lead a normal married life with Joseph after the birth of Jesus Christ. And then they also teach her bodily assumption into heaven. She was supposedly taken in body and spirit up into heaven without ever sinning. In addition to the three teachings, Rome also says that Mary hears, answers prayer, and according to Rome's own statements, their own creeds, and the Council of Trent, that her images are also to be venerated. Now you might be asking yourself again, how a church that claims to be Christian, not only Christian but the one true church, could have steered so far away from the Mary of Scriptures. And of course, the basic answer lies in Mystery Babylon. Mystery Babylon is the source of all of these false teachings. There is a fascinating book entitled, The Two Babylons, written by Alexander Hislop. It is a very informative and detailed book that teaches the origins of many false teachings today, and how they evolved from ancient Babylon into Romanism. According to this book, Nimrod was a mighty hunter before the Lord. Nimrod built up a ziggurat temple, the Tower of Babel, which was his political headquarters. It was also a step temple for the worship of the host of heaven, and at the top of it were the signs of the zodiac. Now we recall Nimrod was slain and his body was cut into pieces. But he was survived by his wicked consort, Semiramis. She gave birth to a child, whether it was Nimrod's or whether it was somebody else's child is a matter for dispute, but she produced this child and claimed it was the reincarnation of her dead husband. And she set herself up for worship as the mother goddess and the queen of heaven. And there in ancient Babylon developed the worship of the heavenly mother and the cult of the mother and child, the little baby in the arms of the mother goddess. This cult spread, along with many other apostate teachings, right out of Babylon. In Egypt, the queen of heaven was worshipped as Isis, the mother goddess. The ancient Etruscans in Italy worshipped her as Nutria. In Greece, it was Aphrodite the mediatrix. In India, the mother goddess was worshipped as Devaki. In China, the mother goddess was worshipped as Xingmu. In Tibet, she is known as Tara. In Ephesus, if you know your Bible, she was known as the mother goddess, Diana. Great was Diana, the goddess of the Ephesians. But when then Apostle Paul preached to the people of Ephesus, they accepted Jesus Christ as their savior and denounced the false worship of a mother goddess. They denounced her at the chagrin of the pagan priests. Remember something important, our biblical Israelite forefathers were idolaters. They broke God's commandment repeatedly and they were rebuked by God for worshipping or venerating Baal and Ashtaroth, the pagan queen of heaven. Please turn to Judges chapter 2 and verses 12 and 13 for a confirmation. And they forsook the Lord, and served Baal and Ashtaroth. And the anger of the Lord was hot against Israel, and he delivered them into the hands of spoilers that spoiled them, and he sold them into the hands of their enemies round about, so that they could not any longer stand before their enemies. Jeremiah rebuked and condemned the women of Judah and of Jerusalem, and declared that one of the damnable sins that brought the destruction of the city, and temple, was the offering up of cakes in worship to the Queen of Heaven. Turn to Jeremiah chapter 7 verses 1 and 18. The word that came to Jeremiah from the Lord, saying, the children gather wood, and the fathers kindle the fire, and the women knead their dough, to make cakes to the Queen of Heaven, and to pour out drink offerings unto other gods, that they may provoke me to anger. The term Queen of Heaven is found only 5 times in the Bible, and all of them are found in the book of Jeremiah in the Old Testament. Each time the term Queen of Heaven is used, it always, each and every time, is followed by anger and the wrath of God. Recall Exodus 20. Thou shalt have no other gods before me. For I am a jealous God. I personally believe the true Church of God was formed at Pentecost. Pentecost was the day the apostles and others received the gift of the Holy Spirit, 10 days after the ascension of Jesus Christ into heaven. But Satan knows his time is short, so he wastes no time. The Church of God began to apostatize even before Roman Emperor Constantine's death in 337 AD, but much more rapidly afterwards. Constantine the Great experienced a reserved conversion to Christianity. Even though he claimed religious freedom in 313 AD, and that Christianity was now the official state religion, he was not baptized until just before his death. He still had an important job as the head of pagan worship, and he still had some murders and sins to commit. I suspect he wanted to make sure he got it all out of his system before he had to walk the straight and narrow. So, the big shift from paganism to Christianity began. The emperor was now supposedly Christian, so all the subjects wanted to follow suit. When in Rome, do as the emperor does. The emperor reciprocated and found ways to ease his subjects into his newfound religion. Changing gods was easy, but the people really loved their Queen of Heaven. Subsequently, every effort was made to incorporate and to find a place for this old mother goddess within the confines of the Christian Church. It was a process of joining Christianity to paganism, what we call synchronism. Well, Rome found the answer. So, they said, in essence, hey listen, don't call her by all those pagan names anymore, the real name of the mother goddess is Mary, the mother of Jesus. And so they began to be merged, they began to be blended, they began to put it all together. Emperor Constantine, unfortunately, caused more harm than good. He brought all the pagans into Christianity because it was the popular to have the same religion as the emperor. They didn't convert because of faith, but they converted because it was stylish. So, multitudes, tens of thousands, entered into God's church as nominal Christians. They never had a change of heart, mind, or a renewing of spirit. Instead, they brought their old pagan doctrines in with them. Before Constantine's death, he called a church council in 325 AD at Nicaea. And out of that church council came a wide array of false doctrines, false teachings, and these pagan ideas began to be given a new Christian veneer. But it wasn't until 431 AD that a council of the so-called Roman Church put into writing a special doctrine regarding Mary. The Council of Ephesus was convened in the very city which had been given over for generations to the worship of the mother goddess, Diana. The representatives of the visible Church of God upon earth declared that Mary was officially the Mother of God. Now, of course, we know that that is incorrect. She was the mother of the human manifestation of God, the mighty God who came in the form of the baby at Bethlehem. Mary was only the mother of his humanity. Mary is the mother of Jesus, the human Jesus of Nazareth, the one in whom all fullness dwelt. But to describe her as the mother of his divinity, or as mother of God, is a dangerous, false, pagan, superstitious Babylonish doctrine. Now it is strange that no more official dogmas were to be proclaimed regarding her for 1,400 years. But during that time a series of traditions and superstitions grew. One of the most prominent promoters of the Mary Mother of God cult was a Franciscan theologian named Saint Bonaventure. He lived from 1221 to 1274 AD and had a happy little time changing the Word of God. Bonaventure spent his days taking the Book of Psalms, writing out the name of God and Jesus, and inserting the name of Mary. Blessed is a man that loveth that name, O Mary, thy grace shall strengthen his heart. That God, my God, turns his face towards me. Thanks to thy merit, O Mary, always virgin. In thee, O Lady, have I trusted. I will not be confounded, in thy grace I am upheld. Thou art my strength and refuge, into thy hands, O Lady, I commit my spirit. Incline the face of thy Son towards us and oblige him to have pity upon us. O my soul, bless the Mother of Jesus. And though in my inward parts glorify. Everlasting salvation is in thy hand, O Lady, they who would virtually honor thee will obtain in her name. Sins are remitted by her grace and sickness is healed by her mercy. The Lord said to Our Lady, My Mother, sit on my right hand till I make thy enemies thy footstool. Now I could go on, but this is disgusting, erasing God from his own word. This is blatant blasphemy, and this is Rome's official teaching. Let these priests of Rome who claim they don't worship Mary, and who claim that they are evangelical Catholics today, let them come forward publicly and repudiate Saint Bonaventure as a saint of their church. Let them repudiate the Psalms that he revised which denies the Lord his due worship, rather the old pagan Queen of Heaven. This is the Mary of Romanism, and how Rome insists you see her. This is not the Mary of the Bible. Let us come forward in time. From 1347 to 1380 AD, there lived another saint of Rome, Saint Catherine. She was a Dominican nun described as a mystic. The truth of the matter was she was anorexic. She was a flagellant who whipped her body and apparently spent the last few years of her life eating nothing but Host wafers. In 1970, she was the first illiterate and the second woman ever to be declared a doctor of the church. It was this woman who proclaimed that Saturday is Mary's special day. Then we find another person here, Saint Bernardine. Saint Bernadette of Lourdes was a French nun who lived in the 1800s. As a young teenager, she had a series of 18 visions of the Virgin Mary in the Lourdes Grotto, ultimately leading to the founding of the shrine. She was supposedly told by Virgin Mary to build a shrine to her honor where the faithful could come and adore her. Now here comes a Carmelite nun, Saint Teresa of Avila, in Spain. She was one that levitated, and we all know that levitation is a devilish work. She was the one who began to propagate the Immaculate Conception, the bodily assumption, and the coronation of Mary in heaven. Now there is a little Catholic book called the Holy Rosary. There is a picture within depicting Jesus taking the crown off his own head and crowning his mother Queen of Heaven. Now if you can show me that in the Bible, I will send you a prize. If any Romanist can show me from the scriptures where Jesus crowned his mother, I'll give you commemorative plaque and a fondue set. And there is another little picture to tell you about. Many of the basilicas in Rome have huge paintings upon the ceilings which depict the same scene, Christ removes his crown and puts his crown upon the head of his mother. It was Saint Teresa who said Mary was Queen of Angels and Queen of Heaven. She also said, Christ's death would never have been necessary if the apostles had had as much faith as Mary. Well, we learned in the previous video that Mary didn't have all that much faith at all. Teresa also said, Mary has the power to restrain us from falling into mortal sin. Through Mary's merits, we gain everything we've lost through our sins. This is totally contrary to the scriptures, and this is real Romanism professed in their own words. When the ecumenical ministers tell you we have got to unite with Rome, and that Rome is a sister Christian church, you have to denounce them. You have got to tell them you will not be going back to Romanism. You might as well join hands with the Mormons or Jehovah Witnesses, because the Word of God makes it clear you cannot go back to Rome. On the contrary, the Word of God tells you to come out of her. We looked at this before, but let us turn again, Revelation chapter 18 verses 4 and 5. And I heard another voice from heaven, saying, Come out of her, my people, that ye be not partakers of her sins, and that ye receive not of her plagues. For her sins have reached unto heaven, and God hath remembered her iniquities. Now there was another leading member of their church named St. Louis de Montfort. He was educated by the Jesuits and, before his death, founded two women's orders called the Sisters of Wisdom, and Company of Mary. He wrote two books, The True Devotion to Mary, and, The Secret of the Rosary. In these books, he proclaimed that Mary was the second Eve, Mary was the tree of life, and that she began and will finish the salvation of the world. And he was the first to teach the devilish doctrine, through Mary to Jesus. In other words, we have to go to the Lord Jesus through his mother, for she is the mediatrix, or mediator. He actually taught the Roman Catholic people that the angels in heaven are singing, Holy, 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 Mary, Mother of God. He was the first one to demand of devout Catholics that they make an act of consecration, consecrating their body, mind and spirit, to the service of Mary. He said that Satan fears Mary more than God himself. Mary is this dwelling place of the Trinity, and he says that we are to bless Our Lady first and Our Lord second. I challenge these Romanists to denounce St. Louis de Montfort for these heretical teachings. Let them say this is not part of their official writings. And then I guess the one who tops it all out, of course, is St. Alphonsus Liguori. Now, we have a little book from him too. He wrote a book called, The Glories of Mary. In this big fat book he says, God could not have become a man without the consent of Mary. No one is saved except through Mary. Mary is mistress of heaven. Mary is the salvation of all who call upon her. Those who love their beads have a very great assurance of salvation. They are saved in heaven, for whom the Queen of Heaven intercedes. Others follow the Lamb. But the Lamb followeth Mary, having become subject to her. All things are subject to the command of Mary, even God himself. These types of comments leave me speechless. How dare the Pope canonize a man who speaks such blasphemy against our Almighty God? But listen, he also wrote little stories in his book, and these stories are even worse than everything else. I think this is absolutely appalling. He told the tale of two ladders. He said, Brother Leo in vision saw two ladders, one red and at the summit of which was Jesus Christ. The other ladder was white and at the top of which presided his Blessed Mother. He observed that those who tried to ascend the first ladder after mounting a few steps fell down, and in trying again were equally unsuccessful. They never reached the top. But a voice told them to try the white ladder instead, and they gained the top because the Blessed Virgin extended her hand to them and helped them up. All of this degrades the Lord Jesus and his finished work on Calvary. Protestants and the average Roman Catholic people must realize that Romanism degrades and dethrones the Lord Jesus, and raises up his mother into his place. What the Roman Church has done is revive the old Babylonish Queen of Heaven under the Blessed Mary's name. Let us come closer to modern times. You would have thought that the Reformation would have shook Rome up so much they wouldn't have added more error. But, in point of fact, the Roman Church today is worse than when Martin Luther left it, because it has added other damnable Mary doctrines. In 1854 Pope Pius IX proclaimed, officially and as a doctrine of the Catholic Church, the Immaculate Conception of Mary. He proclaimed that Mary was born free of any taint of original sin. Therefore, she would not have any need for a Savior. Yet we learn from the Bible, all have sinned. Please turn to Romans chapter 5 and verse 12. Wherefore, as by one man sin entered into the world, and death by sin, and so death passed upon all men, for that all have sinned. Turn back to Romans chapter 3 and verse 23. For all have sinned, and come short of the glory of God. The Bible says that we all have sinned. It does not say or imply, all have sinned except Mary. On the contrary, Mary herself said in her Magnificat that she was a sinner and in need of a Savior as well. She did not exalt herself, but acknowledged she was a lowly servant of God. As we read the verses in the last chapter, the Gospel of Luke says Mary proclaimed, My spirit hath rejoiced in God my Savior. But the Pope said no. He says, no. She was immaculately conceived. And he forcefully continues, We must believe that the Blessed Virgin Mary was immaculate in her conception. There is no salvation in the world to those who would not so believe. Such absolute nonsense. But still Rome had not elevated Mary quite high enough. In 1950, Pope Pius XII, Hitler's Pope as they called him, the Nazi Pope, the one who helped bring Adolf Hitler and Mussolini to power, proclaimed officially as a doctrine of the Church, the bodily assumption of the Virgin Mary, Mary's glorious assumption, as they call it. This meant that since Mary did not have the taint of original sin, nor did she sin in her lifetime, so she could not have died. Subsequently, she was transported body and soul directly to heaven. This is when her supposed coronation took place. Jesus took off his crown in heaven and placed it upon his mother. This is a blasphemous and heretical doctrine. We are fundamental Bible-believing Christians, and we turn away from evil and false doctrines. We accept what the Bible teaches us, and the Bible teaches there is one God. There is only one God who is worthy of worship and praise, the same great and mighty God coming in the person of our Lord Jesus Christ. There is only one mediator between God and men, no mediatrix. One advocate, friend and refuge of sinners. The only hope in the world, whether Catholic or Christian, is the Lord Jesus Christ who died for our sins. Let us look at Christ's crucifixion in Luke chapter 23 verses 39 through 43. And one of the malefactors which were hanged railed on him, saying, If thou be Christ, save thyself and us. But the other answering rebuked him, saying, Dost not thou fear God, seeing thou art in the same condemnation? And we indeed justly, for we receive the due reward of our deeds, but this man hath done nothing amiss. And he said unto Jesus, Lord, remember me when thou comest into thy kingdom. And Jesus said unto him, Verily I say unto thee today, shalt thou be with me in paradise. The thief was hanging on the cross, he was in a bad way, and so was the Lord Jesus in his humanity, in a very bad way. The thief didn't look down to the so-called Mother of God and say, Oh Hail Mary, help us. Get the three of us down off these crosses. Oh, Mary, save us. The thief never even gave her a second glance. The damned thief turned to Jesus and said, Lord, remember me when you come into your kingdom. And Jesus said, in the literal, Behold. I am saying to you today of all days, you shall be with me in paradise, in the kingdom that is coming. There is only one way into God's kingdom and that is made perfectly clear. Jesus is the door. Jesus is the shepherd of the sheep. We are not degrading the Virgin Mary in any way. We are not putting any slur upon her, but we are saying what the Bible teaches. She was just another sinner saved by grace. She can't help anybody. She can't hear us pray. Mary, the mother of Jesus, is with all the rest of the dead who hear nothing because there is silence in the grave. She is not up anywhere dancing round the throne and interceding, praying, listening into your requests, or any of this nonsense. We have one who hears us today. We may not be able to see him now, but he is here by his Holy Spirit. I don't care what problem you may have, he can solve that problem for you. I don't care what your sickness is or what sin you may have committed, Jesus Christ shed enough blood to wash away the sins of all who call upon his name. God tells us to test doctrines against his word. He gave us scriptures for guidance. God also warns us that we will worship him in vain. We will let go of his word and follow the commandments of men. Please turn to John chapter 4 and verse 1. Beloved, believe not every spirit, but try the spirits whether they are of God, because many false prophets are gone out into the world. And Mark chapter 7 verse 7. Howbeit in vain do they worship me, teaching for doctrines the commandments of men. In the book of James, God reveals that the followers of his word, the true Christian church, will not be popular. He continually warns us that we ask incorrectly, we ask in ways other than his way. We ask in our own pagan and lustful way. James chapter 2 and verses 2 through 4. Ye ask, and receive not, because ye ask amiss, that ye may consume it upon your lusts. Ye adulterers and adulteresses, know ye not that the friendship of the world is enmity with God? Whosoever therefore will be a friend of the world is the enemy of God. Please turn to Luke 6:26. Woe unto you, when all men shall speak well of you. For so did their fathers to the false prophets. I am telling you something right now, Jesus Christ will not be sharing David's throne with anybody. His mother will not be sitting on David's throne. She will not be there at his right hand giving him instructions or telling him what to do. He shall reign forever and ever as King of Kings, and Lord of Lords. This is what your Bible says. What a contrast to what Rome teaches. By the time you read and make notes in your Bible, you will be able to witness to dear Roman Catholic people and others. You will be able to contrast official Roman doctrine with the very Word of God. Now for any movement to advance, for any cult to operate, for any false teaching to be expanded, it needs people who are dedicated to it, totally dedicated to propagating and even dying for its causes. Rome has an army and legions today enrolled in solidarities, confraternities, and movements within the Roman Church specifically dedicated to propagating the message of Mary. A little more sly, but still ending in death, spiritual death, and eternal damnation. We have all heard of rosary beads, but have you ever heard of a scapular? This is a nifty little item worn under the clothing of some Roman Catholics. They come in different colors, they serve different purposes, and produce varying miracles. Best of all, they are all for sale. I have even seen brown scapular coloring books for sale on the internet. They truly like starting kids out early. A scapular is two embroidered pieces of cloth connected by a cord or thin piece of material. It is worn around the back of the neck and across each shoulder under the shirt or blouse. I hear they cost less than 10 bucks, which is a great price for salvation. According to papal statements, if a person wears the scapular, they get so much time out of a non-existent purgatory. If the wearer kisses the scapular, they get an additional time out of purgatory. Here's the real deal: if a person dies while wearing the scapular, his or her soul is released from purgatory by Mary on the first Saturday following the death. So, the person that really gets their money's worth is the person who dies Friday evening while wearing the scapular. The popes urge the use of these sacramental relics, which means I won't be getting one anytime soon. The beloved Pope John Paul II, who daily prayed the rosary and urges all to pray it, underlined the supreme role of devotion to Mary in the family theme and the importance of the rosary as a family devotion. The Pope then introduced a new thought which made every year a Marian year. He devoted his whole papacy to the devotion of Mary. Frankly, I don't need some superstitious piece of junk hanging round my neck like a voodoo doll out in the jungle. I don't need that at all. Hosea the prophet says, God's people are destroyed because of the lack of knowledge. Please turn to Hosea chapter 4 verse 6. My people are destroyed for lack of knowledge, because thou hast rejected knowledge, I will also reject thee, that thou shalt be no priest to me, seeing thou hast forgotten the law of thy God, I will also forget thy children. That is what is wrong with us. We don't have knowledge. We don't have knowledge of the Bible, let alone of the enemy. Do you ever watch quiz shows on television? I like to watch them, and I like to see how many questions I can answer. Most contestants do very well. However, if the contestant is asked a Bible question, be sure they have gone through phone a friend, ask the audience and everything else that you can do. It's because nobody knows Bible stories. I challenge any of those quiz programs to ask Bible questions. Because if they do, the contestant might as well forget it, they've lost the game. Pack the Samsonite, and take your parting gift. Our people don't know the Word of God. They don't know the Lord's Prayer. They don't know the very basics of scriptures. How many of our Protestant people know all the Ten Commandments? How many of them know you should not make a graven image or bow down to it? Sure, it's just a little statue on my dashboard, and what harm comes from that? People are inundated with various idols everywhere, and we have become numb to them. Because of our complacency, because of our lack of knowledge, because we are in the Laodicea church age, we are succumbing to the ways of the Roman Babylon. You know what the scripture says: if you put the people in remembrance of these things, you will be a good minister of Jesus Christ. You know what it didn't say? It didn't say you would be a popular witness. I have no chance of that. I have long since blown it, as the saying goes. But I am going to try to be a good servant to God as He tells me to do. And if people don't like this, that is unfortunate. God says not only are we to preach the positive and the Word of God, but we have to preach the whole truth. We should not select or sugarcoat scriptures, but preach the whole Word of God as He gives it to us. We have got to expose and pull down errors as we compare religious doctrines with the Bible. If you found this video informative, please smash the like button. Thank you. And may God continue to bless and guide your studies.